Lady a break about that now.
I'm not going to give a not nary a break because when the dope problem was at its height, she gave it lip service, running around here talking about just say no. And revelations revealed that her and her husband were smoking dope out there in California.
Well, then call her down on that, but don't call her down on something she can't help. She can help her choices about what she does with drugs and that kind of thing, but she can't help she had to have a mastectomy.
All right.
You know what I'm saying?
You make some sense. I won't call her one-breasted.
Well, I'd appreciate it. Anything else you want to say about her that, you know, she can do something about, I think is fine.
Okay.
Okay.
All right.
Thanks, Ralph.
Thank you, Valerie.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye, darling. All right. Okay. This is what they call an attack of the silly. It's like, yeah. That lady hailed for almost 20 minutes because I talked about that. Now, let me get serious. We have had some good first ladies. We have had some pretty good first ladies. First of all, they are not elected. They are not elected to office. Their husbands are elected, and they come in, and I don't want to be demeaning, but they come in like baggage. Some first ladies have an agenda. It's unfortunate that in the past few Republican administrations, we've had pill-taking alcoholic drunks like Betty Ford and crazy Pat Nixon, Nancy Reagan, you know, running around here like she's some kind of royalty going over there trying to thumb her nose at Gorbachev's wife. What's Gorbachev's wife's name? Razor garbage truck. You know, she thumbed her nose at Razor garbage truck. And all of them tried to put down, I think, a fine lady, Jimmy Carter's wife. And they tried to put down Mrs. Carter, who was a fine person, who is a fine person. The organization that I work for in the daytime, she took us on as her pet charity, and she helped work with underprivileged youth. She's a very, very good person, unsung hero, and they called her Plain Jane, a local yokel, and all those kinds of things, and she was a very good person. People always trying to put down Eleanor Roosevelt, saying that she was ugly, you know, and whatnot, and she was an in-lover, you know. But Nancy Reagan, to me, is the epitome of hypocrisy, and whatever digs, whatever dozens I can throw up at her, I like to do it. Don't let me start laughing again, but I just can't help it. I love the dog Nancy Reagan out. To me, she is poor white trash. Derek in Stone Mountain, you're on the talk how you like Posse.
Hey, what's up, bro?
What's
going on?
Nothing.
Listen.
Hey, cut your radio way down. Sound like we in the Omni or something, man.
Sorry, my brother.
All right, my brother.
I respect you.
I respect you, my friend.
There you go.
I don't know you, but I respect you. I give you that.
You know me from the A-Chain, Ralph.
Oh, yeah, Derek.
I got my car down there.
Yeah, yeah.
I wanted to do a function.
You the one that ate off my plate after I got through. No.
Stop that. Anyway, I just wanted to call and check in and let you know that although you're not on the airwaves on Saturday and Sundays, that your vibe and your positiveness and the whole mentality is still carried over on the weekend because I do a jazz set on Saturday nights at the Frozen Paradise out there on Old National.
I'm coming by there, man. I'm coming by there.
Yeah.
I got to stop by.
Now, see, I listened last week and Jacques LaRose from the Jacques LaRose Trio, he plays out there.
Mm-hmm.
But I had just started DJing.
He need to change his last name, man. What is it? La Roche?
La Roche.
That's French for the rope of the bug. Jacques the bug. Jacques La Roche.
Good brother, though. He spoke highly of you.
Yeah, he's cool people. I love his wife.
Yeah. See, in between sets, me and him, when he first came in the setup, I asked him, I told him I didn't know that he was a part of the Talk How You Like Posse.
What instrument does Jacques play?
He plays guitar league.
What about you?
Me? I play the turntables.
Oh, okay.
You know?
I got you.
I'm a musician when it comes to the turntables.
Yeah.
Also in the studio. I'm part of Bobby Brown's crew.
Okay.
Yeah. At the same token, though, I just want to let you know the positiveness is still flowing, and you know, I'm too woman oriented to touch upon that homosexualness that's going on tonight. I'm not even going to feed into that, because brothers need to wake up and realize that you know, women have been our downfall for a long time, but that can bring you to hell. That's the infinity fall.
With a quickness.
You cannot recover from that fall. And see, women have brought us down, but a strong woman is out there for each and every strong brother.
Mm-hmm.
There's a strong woman out there. Mm-hmm. And you see my woman, Ralph, down the A-Train, so you know I got me a little, you know, a lovely honey. And I peeped your honey in Ebony Magazine. You got a sweet young lady.
I can't claim possession yet, brother, but I'm working on it.
Well, you working on it.
Gotta
be friends before you can be anything else.
There you go. That's
yeah.
The foundation that all good relationships are built on.
There you go. Listen,
mm-hmm.
I just want to touch bases because I think I got a couple of free days. I'm going to get in touch with you as far as, you know, what we talked about down the A-Train.
Yeah.
And
what did we talk about?
About me coming and sitting in with you once a couple of days.
Yeah, that'll work.
Okay.
All right.
And I don't know if you got any more ticket stuff. I just, you know, I never seen James Brown.
Well, I got two tickets to see. You want to see Janet Jackson?
I want to see Janet. I want to see James Brown. I want to be at the AIDS benefit, whatever function you can, you know.
All right.
I'm not a beggar. I just want, you know, I'm about music, and I love all types of music. And
being
a DJ, you got to be very versatile. So I'm about all types of music.
I'm going to put you on hold and give you two tickets to see Janet Jackson get off an airplane on TV. Bye, Derek. Gonna come back to Bev. 233-WGST. The sucker called up. I ain't gonna call him a sucker. You're not a sucker, Derek. When he calls up, he pumps up the Frozen Paradise. That's a $700 commercial right there. He pumps up Jock, you know, and then he wants some tickets. Oh, me. Nancy Reagan.
Are you too stressed out to have sex? I'm Dr. Rita Hayter. Call me
Never.
For help on For Adults Only, Saturday night from 7 to 10.
Never too
on
stressed out.
WGST.
Never.
It's Kinko's 2.5 cent coffee sale, where we'll take your originals and give you an incredible value. For only 2.5 cents each, the highest quality black and white auto-fed coffees on 20-pound bond. At just 2.5 cents a copy is...
I search low and I search high, trying to find myself a cutie pie. But destination leads me to a dead end, over and over and over again. They told me to wait, so I waited, anticipated, debated, and delayed it. But still came up with the same old thing.
Limb alive, nothing.
It seems as if every time I find the right girl, she turns out to be the very wrong girl. Tell me, y'all, when will this madness stop? I want somebody to love me for me, not because I'm MC Heavy D. I'm looking for a love that's as solid as a rock.
Hi, Ralph. This is Sean Robinson. How are you? My number is... Hi, Ralph. This is Sean Robinson. How are you? My number is 414. Talk to you later. Bye.
Now, maybe I'll take a trip around the world and find myself a beautiful gorgeous girl. They say when you look, one never finds. They also say that love is blind. It ain't that blind that I can't see. Somebody out there who's perfect for me. Somebody who's gonna love me for me. Love, that's what I'm talking about.
A relationship. Bev in Lilburn, you're on the Talk How You Like Posse, Bev.
Hi there, how are you?
Great, Bev.
That's good.
You are a veteran of talk radio. You're one of my heroes. I used to listen to you talking to Chris DeValla, Mike Malloy, Ludlow, Wes Minner. You are a vet.
I never talked to Miss West. Never.
You never talked to Miss West?
I wouldn't waste my time. Now, in reference to Chief Bootylazy.
Bootylazy.
Yes, you forgot to mention, or whatever, you can't remember everything, how he associates and is in cahoots and plays tootsie toes with the white nasty thug-type police in South Africa.
Correct.
To the detriment of his people.
Correct.
Being killed and injured and maimed. That's what I hold against him. Instead, Mr. Mandela has done so many things to better conditions for his people. Mr. Bootylazy doesn't do that. I've read and heard that he owns 7 very expensive cars. 8 cars. What does a man need 8 cars for when his people are running around in such deplorable condition?
Mm-hmm. Good point.
I just don't feel that he's for his people at all.
He's not. He's not. And, you know, George Bush didn't want the sanctions in place in the first place.
No, neither did Reagan.
Right, neither did Reagan. And any little excuse, even if it was a booty lazy, coming over here with a, you know, well, lazy was slick. We didn't give him any credit for being as shrewd as he was. He came over and he finessed and finagled and he got George Bush to drop the sanctions.
Oh, Bush would have been ready to drop them for any reason at all.
Well, I think booty lazy gave him the reason.
Oh, I'm sure he contributed to it. No doubt about it.
Mm-hmm.
No doubt about it.
Bev, it's good to hear from you.
Yes, I enjoy listening to you, and I have never laughed so hard.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know when I did this evening. It's wonderful.
Okay.
You're very talented. You're very amusing.
Okay.
Sometimes you're goofy, but you're great.
Okay, thank you, Bev.
Bye-bye.
Don't start me to laugh. Thank you, bye-bye. Don't start me to laughing again. Oh, boy, the things that upset people around here. I mean, you know, come on. Let's face it. The lady can't help it. And she had breast cancer, and I shouldn't be laughing about it. Mike in Buckhead, you're on the talk. How you like, Posse?
How you doing, Ralph?
Doing all right, Mike.
Yeah, I like to talk about these mergers going on in America with all these corporations.
Okay.
And the results of these layoffs and all these unemployed people.
Okay. Okay.
And what are we going to do with all these people that's being laid off?
Well, there was a guy by the name of John Cassandra when I was a black hippie once upon a time in the pre-revolutionary days. He made a jam that's talking about you built all these computers and you left me behind. He was saying how we could handle mules and tools, but when they built these computers, they left us behind. And these computers, man, and this new age of technology that we've entered, it's really boggled my mind in that we get a computer or a robot on a job that can do the job of 10 or 20 people, and that's automatically creating a force of people, a great force of people that are going to be unemployed. And I just really, for the life of me, I'm not a business-minded person. I'm a good sociologist. I'm a pretty good politician, but business-wise, I lack a lot of good qualities. But I know I don't have to be business-minded, Mike, to know that unemployment is really, really a big problem, and it's getting worse.
Right. You know, I think one positive thing that may come out of this,
mm-hmm.
I think it's going to create such a terrible social conditions that people may develop the attitudes we had in the 60s and start getting back into the movement. You know, you can notice a lot of social programs or social activity on the rise, human rights issues, environmental issues. But most important, I think, in the black community, you know, things are going to get so rough at some point. It wouldn't surprise me if it developed into another civil war, you know, maybe some 10, 20 years down the road.
You know, I would not like to see that, Mike. But what I would like to see, you know, and I know we can't take everybody back to the 60s again, and nor should we. I would like to see a conscience level like we had in the 60s. But what I would really like to see, Mike, is black people using and taking advantage of all these examples that we have before us. You know, the Jews take a terrible whooping, and I know I get on Israel a lot of times, and I'm not getting on the Jews. I'm getting on the state of Israel when I do that. But I like to look at the Jews all the time for all kinds of examples, positive examples. One is the way that they network and the way that they do their business and the way they do for self and kind. You don't see the Jews running around here begging and crying and kneeling in and praying in and crawling in and standing in and sitting in. They take care of serious business. And if black people would only look at the Jews and see how they do their thing, and we could get back to some of the old things that we used to do so well that were alike some of the things that the Jews are doing now, we'd be a lot better off. We could look at the Koreans. Right here in this country, first and second generation Koreans succeeding, where six and seven and eight generation black people are failing. You know, just plain old, the old time hard work business ethic, the old hard work ethic, we need to reapply to our daily lives and get back to some moral basis and quit trying to go berserk with all of this freedom that we have when in essence we're just as enslaved as we were in 1891.
But, you know, I think a lot of that is due to slavery.
Well, we know it, but we ought to overcome it, man. We have had countless numbers of PhDs and sociologists who have come before us to lay out the problems and analyze and scrutinize and find out what the problem is. We know what the bottom line is. All we got to do is go out here and sweat, man. That's what you know, we're scared to sweat. We don't even want to perspire. You know, we need to get out here, man, and sweat. Sweat, work hard, quit trying to make it rich on these dope games or trying to hit the lottery or trying to get rich quick at a bank robbery or something. You need to get out here and get some land so that we can pass something on to our kids. Don't you know the burden that we could relieve our kids of if they didn't have to pay a house note? The majority of your and our work, our work that we do, goes into a house note and a car note. If we can establish some kind of legacy for our kids so where at least they will have a crib to stay in, you know, or some place to live, and get out of this old crack mentality, this old begging welfare cycle that we're in, and get back to working hard. Man, we're the hardest working people on the planet Earth.
Always have been.
Always have been and always will be. All we need is a program. We need to stop following these old chicken-choking preachers, these old Jerry-curling, moonwalking, double-talking, evangelical, aerobic, African-American, Jesus-loving preachers and get behind a program with some action, a program with some teeth to it, you know?
I'll bet.
233 WGST, 1-800-FON-WGST. Lowest Dollar, I've seen your name up here. Looks like 30 minutes. We're going to come right back to you. Rollo, David, and Marietta. Others are checking in. This is the Ralph from Ben Hill Show. The hottest show. The hottest show in town. No doubt.
There ain't much time.
In 1990, the Friendship Force made history when 300 people from America's Georgia traveled to Soviet Georgia and broke ground in the name of friendship. In 1991, we'll make history again. This time, we're waging peace through friendship in Jerusalem. On October 22nd, hundreds of Atlantans will leave for a two-week stay in the homes of the people of Greater Jerusalem, Jews, Arabs, Christians, and Muslims. Here's your opportunity to do something for peace through friendship in the Middle East. To find out how you can participate, call 222-2001 today.
Hi, I'm Lisa Gibbons. You may know me from Entertainment Tonight, but to my two-year-old little girl, I'm just Mommy, which is why I'm really proud about hosting Lifetime Television's new show, Growing Up Together. What's the best kind of daycare? When is it time for potty training? Is sleeping through the night the impossible dream? On Growing Up Together, we'll help you find the answers. Join me for the parenting show the LA Times rates an A+. Growing Up Together, sponsored by Clorox. Weekday mornings at 9 on Lifetime Television.
1, 2, 3, 4.
Two dirty socks, oh my, oh me. Let's wash this one with Clorox bleach. This dirty sock, let's take it home and wash it too in detergent alone. Now look at those socks, see what we mean. There's only one way to get them Clorox clean.
You can wash them all day, you can wash them all night,
but there's only one way.
Time for another Wall Street Journal business quiz. Sir, when is it good business to lose customers?
Lose customers?
The answer was in the journal. Ma'am, what are the best states for minority-owned businesses?
I don't know.
It was in the journal, too. The Wall Street Journal gives you the whole world of business and how it affects you. Information you know you should know. Sir, when is insider trading legal?
If I knew that, I'd be rich.
Pick up the journal today or call to subscribe, 1-800-345-8000.
It's Kinko's 2.5 cent coffee sale, where we'll take your originals and give you an incredible value. For only 2.5 cents each, the highest quality black and white auto-fed coffees on 20-pound bond. At just 2.5 cents a copy, a small business can look big and every business look better. At participating Kinko's, July 15th through 19th, 24 hours at most Kinko's. Call 1-800-743-COPY for Kinko's, where quality is affordable.
You know I've seen a lot of what the world can do, and it's breaking my heart in two. Because I never want to see you sad, girl. You told me you're a bad girl. But if you want to leave, take good care.
Chad.
Make a lot of nice friends out there.
Chad Stevens.
Just remember there's a lot of bad and beware.
233 WGST, 1-800-FON-WGST. You know, I meant to talk about, from the Ralph from Ben Hill sports page. I wanted to talk about Rick Mailer for a minute here, just a second before we go to Lois. You know, the Braves fired Rick Mailer and put him on waivers or traded him or whatever they did to that sucker. He was nothing. And now they got him back. And they got the nerve to talk about it. I heard Bobby Cox talking about Rick Mailer's got some good stuff. The sucker got in the game and gave up 2 runs. How good is good stuff if you're giving up 2 runs? This sucker Rick Mailer got Bob Gibson fired. He got Joe Torre fired. When we had a good coach, a good pitching coach, and a good coach, baseball coach, and now they got the same team-wrecking sucker Rick Mailer back. Rick Mailer is pitiful. I gotta do a get out of town list and put Rick Mill at the top of it.
Back with another hour of power. Bill, Sonny, Rollo.
The Ralph from Ben Hill Talk How You Like Posse continues.
Athlete's Foot, answer, man.
Is it possible to catch athlete's foot from doing the hokey pokey at a wedding?
No, it's a fungus infection you can get when bare feet contact damp or moist flooring.
Can I get it if my boyfriend Fred steps on my foot while doing the hokey pokey?
No, but tell Fred.
Hi, my yiddy sidekick, Mike Rose. Yeah, right. Greetings, conservatives, across the fruited plain, as we slide down the razor blade of life. Take that! Boy, this is some funky, messed up music. No wonder they get those crazy callers calling in. What is this? Greetings, pilgrims. I want you to tune in to my talk show tonight. We pre-recorded it 7 days ago. Oh, come on. Rollo in College Park. You're on the Talk How You Like Posse.
Ralph, how you living?
I'm living extra large.
Hey, what I want to, I got two things I want to get off my chest.
Get you some Vicks Vapor Rub then, man. No, go ahead.
You're hot tonight, isn't you?
No, I'm just having fun, man. That Nancy Reagan thing kicked me off into the silly willies.
Right.
You know, and I said, hey, man, let me get real, though. Come on.
Okay, what I got?
First of all, let me say it was good to meet your son, Kershawn.
All right. Hey, Ralph, It meant a lot. The things that you did that the day prior to the party.
Well, that's all in the day's work. We won't even get into that.
We're going to get into that, man. That meant a lot to me, man.
Well, we not, like the folks say, we still not through.
All right.
You know, we not through. But it meant a lot to me to meet you and your wife. And, you know, as a first, come on. That's inside radio. Come on.
Okay, well, first of all, I want to talk about that. Power Master, you know, they done pulled it off the shelf.
They have pulled it off the shelf. Now, I understand they're going to change the name, but they're going to remarket the product.
They don't call it Black Power.
Now, they're going to change the name to Smooth Master or something like that.
Ooh.
But my main man, Calvin Butts, he's the minister up there, the pastor of Abyssinian Baptist Church, one of the greatest Baptist Christian churches in the world up there in Harlem. He whitewashed a bunch of billboards when they came out with that cigarette, an uptown cigarette that was targeted at black people.
Right.
And he got behind, right off the bat, he got behind a movement to quench this Power Master thing, man.
Good.
Yeah, I think he's been successful so far.
Good. Okay, now the other thing I want to talk about, I want to get your opinion. What do you think about David Duke supporting Clarence Thomas?
You know, man, I had a big old, the other day, I think the day that we did the show on the nuisance law, I had a big old list of things that was just pointing at Clarence Thomas for all the wrong reasons. Here I am on the same side of David Duke. I'm on the same side of Jeff Dickerson. I'm on the same side of so many people who are against the normal train of thought, like the NAACP and the Joseph Cephas Lazarus and whatnot. And it's just, I don't know. I mean, and here tonight, I'm with Dick Williams. I don't know. I guess no one group of people, no label, no group of people that we like to label has a monopoly on any clear thinking. And I think the clear thinking person, even if you got sheets in your face, you know, and a history of sheets, you know, David Duke came out for Clarence Thomas. And I think that's noble of David, but it might be the kiss of death for Clarence Thomas.
My personal opinion, I think that's the whole intent.
Mm-hmm. You think this is a conspiracy on board George Bush's part? To come up with a black man that you don't think can be appointed, that cannot be approved, and then say, well, we tried, now let's go to who we want, you know. You think he's got a number two waiting in the wings?
I think it's fishy.
It's fishy. Well, if it looks like a fish, and smells like a fish, and swims like a fish, and it's got gills, and it's got scales, and it hit that worm that you threw out there, it's a fish. Speaking of fish, man, just to segue into my family, we were talking about your family. Had an opportunity to be with my kids, you know, playing Weekend Dad this weekend. Had a hell of a time. Let me tell you, we went all over town. I don't need to go through the whole itinerary, but we wound up at home fishing back in the backyard. I got a nice little lake down there, and we caught the kid's granddad was there, and we had them all down. I got the majority of the grandkids, so you know that's a plus on my end, you know, they had the kids there for granddaddy. But we sat there, man, and we baited hooks, and we swatted mosquitoes, and we caught about 9 crappie. And, man, we brought them up to the house. I mean, they were still swimming in the sink. The little girls were playing with them while they were alive. They almost cried when I killed them. But we fried them up, man, with some French fries and some fresh fish, man, and had a ball. And that's what it's all about. You taking your son fishing this summer yet?
Not yet.
Man, that's a lost art. You need to get back into the nature thing, man. I think you can teach a lot of valuable lessons to a child in nature.
Well, I try. I made him a bow and arrow out there.
No, oh, no, come on. A bow and arrow? You trying to make a Robin Hood, man.
Well, I also made him a kite out of the newspaper.
A kite? Okay, well, that's cool, but the wind's not blowing, man. You need to make him a snatch pole. Get you a piece of stick or something and some string and fashion him a hook and make him a snatch pole and teach him how to dig up some worms and y'all go sit on a fish on the bank of a lake or a creek somewhere and don't do nothing for about 3 hours and sit there and get to know each other, man. He'll remember that for the rest of his life.
That's next, man.
You know, and then he can learn valuable lessons. You know, you can teach him lessons from that old pond. You know, there's so many animals in that pond you can learn a lot of lessons from. That old cooter, that old turtle that lives in the pond, he's so smart. He lives to be so many years old. He survives those winters. He eats alive stuff and dead stuff. And then there's those frogs. They make a lot of noise. You ever hear those frogs out there croaking?
Oh, yeah.
Some of our people are like frogs. They make a lot of noise. All that does is tell the snakes exactly where you are, you know? Take him outside, man. Get him out from behind that TV. Get him out from behind that Nintendo. Teach him how to watch a float going up and down in some water, man.
Yeah, right.
Do like the Indians do. Teach him the signs and the ways of nature.
Will do.
All right, Rollo. And when you do that, you'll see some progress in his homework. You'll see some progress in his conduct. Sonny, my main man, Bill in Chapel Hill. I hope he's not one of them big-time Christians. It might be. It might be one of them big pastors up there. That's got to be the biggest church. I mean, have you ever seen the Chapel Hill Harvester up there Flat Hills? That church is humongous. John in Marietta. I'm going to come right back to John and Sonny and Bill. 233-WGST. 1-800-FON-WGST. All we're doing tonight is telling it like it is, you know? That's my job. Tell it like it is, brother.
Can I tell it like it is? Listen to me, baby. It's my heart. It's a song.
Right back. Right back at you. 233-WGST.
This is Walter Reeves. I host Atlanta's best-known, longest-running, long...
Sean, 233-WGST, let's go to Sonny in Decatur. You're on the Talk How You Like Posse. Sonny.
Hey, Ralph, how you living, buddy?
Sonny, well, you talk like a DJ, man. I got to get you down here when I take vacation, at least host one show.
There you go. That won't be any problem. Listen, I'm calling to talk to you about something that happened at your party last week.
Okay.
A great opportunity to go there. It was a lot of good people, a lot of good friends, and for a most worthy cause. But there was a young brother that was standing there throwing some darts, and Neal walked up to him and... told him, the brother obviously had never thrown any darts before, and Neal walked up to him and said, hey, listen, you got to do it like this. Quit trying to throw it like a spear. And that brought back some memories in my mind.
Ooh.
The world.
Ooh.
Well, you know, some people may think
that's
highly insensitive, and it's insensitive or at least ridiculous on my part to take issue with that.
This really happened, man.
Oh, man, absolutely, 100%. And he had the guy on his show the next day talking about it, and Neal was referring to the guy, what a great sport he was. But I didn't know who Neal was, but I watched as he came up, and he was extremely uncomfortable to be there, and his wife was more extremely to be there, at least a young lady with him that was standing there. And I thought about that was the reason I left the corporate world because of...
Wait a minute. Before you go, I can't let it go.
Go ahead.
I'm going to be honest with you.
Go ahead.
And you know me.
All right.
We know each other.
Mm-hmm.
Neal has been very supportive of me.
I can appreciate that.
I mean, I'm talking about from day one. Before I even got the job, I went to him and asked him some things about the money. And he gave me some pretty good advice about the money free. And, you know, to be honest now, you know, the man could have eaten me alive. He could have eaten me alive, bitten me and spit me out and bitten me. He could have taken a bite out of me and spit me out, you know, whole. Because he's been in the business and he knows all the tricks, So
I'm not calling to bash Neal.
All right.
Calling.
Now it don't mean that we in love, you know what I'm saying? But I definitely respect the man from a business perspective, and personally, I respect him.
I can understand it, but again, it brought back to me some of the main reasons why I left the corporate world. When I was able to achieve the success I did at a very young age in the corporate world, it was told to me that I was the first black man to have this position in the company. How gratified and extremely thankful I should be for the position, whereas in true essence, I gained that position because of my productivity.
And your hard work, right.
And that was the bottom line, period.
They fired about 10 other white dudes and hired you.
Well, it brought back the insensitivity that in the corporate world, the things that people say to one another, especially a white man's way of communicating with a brother is always usually through some kind of...
Ethnic humor.
Yeah, ethnic humor or... or backhand compliment.
What's going on, bro?
Yeah.
It's nice to eat a big cotton, isn't it?
Yeah, that sort of thing.
Right. That's not how you throw it. Don't throw it like a spear.
And then when you take offense to that, they feel that you're a militant.
Wait a minute. You're too black. Yeah, right. Well, what are you wearing your blackness on your shoulder for?
Exactly. You're not playing along with the game. You're not a true company person, things of that nature. But one of the things I wanted you to at least throw out to some of your white male listeners, female listeners as well.
You think we got some?
I think there's some closet people out there, and I believe your show's being recorded.
I know I got some, man. I got a lot of them.
Well, but in addition to that, one of the things I wanted you to at least throw out to your listeners is the fact that the disgust, there's a tremendous amount of white females that feel extremely, extremely scared of black men because of the myths that have been perpetuated over through the news media.
That's what their men teach them.
And things of that.
Yeah, their men teach them. And they taught us that the white woman is taboo.
Exactly.
Don't go near Buana's woman. White woman, taboo. Evil. Evil spirit, taboo.
Especially than one-breasted women.
I never laughed so hard before in my life. I never thought I'd lose it down here, you know. But hey, Sonny. Come on, quickly, baby brother.
Really, one of the things I wanted to at least throw out to you, let's just have some white males come in and talk about their uncomfortableness in talking to black men and without the use of racial slurs or without the use of that kind of ethnic humor, which is tiresome after a while, especially if you spent 15, 20 years in the corporate world as a black man.
Well, you know, and I made the point earlier that if a black man is to rise in the corporate structure, he's got to lose a lot of his ethnicity. He's got to go over to the white culture as opposed to them accepting his blackness and his culture. I had a job as a foreman on a carpenter crew in construction, and you have a very low intellectual quota when you're in construction. You find a lot of high school dropouts, a lot of stump jumpers, and you got a lot of Kango hat gold teeth wearers, too, you know, in construction. But my foreman noted one time, you're the most militant foreman I've ever had out here. You're too conscious. You're too racist. I used to motivate my men through work. I never will forget, I was on a fairly popular project, and I always refer to this project, when we revitalized part of downtown. They had a white guy, and his name was David. David was going with the boss's daughter, you know, and he had a bad 55 Chevrolet that he had fixed up, and he was the essence of the little white boy, you know, the Fonzie type carpenter white boy with his bad souped up car.
Yeah, cool, huh?
Yeah, Budweiser in the trunk, had a cooler, you know, and he was just bad. So they put him on one side of the street with a crew, and his crew was white, and they put me on one side of the street, on the other side of the street with a crew that was black. I had a brother named James, who could rub the hell out of some concrete, if you know what rubbing cement means.
Absolutely.
He was a hell of a concrete finisher. Mm. But they told us, okay, we got 43 tree planters to build. Man, we worked them suckers into the ground and loved it all, you know. Mm. We would form them, we would pour them, and we would wreck them all in one day. And we would lay our own work out. They tried to slow us down by telling the engineer to lay out the white boys' work first, but we would lay out our own work. We'd pull off that center line, man, and lay that structure out, form it up, pour the concrete in there, and wreck it every day. Hey, at least two a day. They couldn't understand it. But, you know, the trick was we were working ourselves out of a job. Sonny, appreciate your call, my man. Appreciate your call. And the laugh. Bill in Chapel Hill, John in Marietta, and the American Dread. I got an explanation for you, American Dread, when we come right back. 233-WGST. 1-800-FON-WGST. For lovers the world over. Designed to make your knees freeze, your liver quiver, and your bladder splatter. I am disaster. I will be your master.
Here I lay all alone.
Let me shine.
Toss and turn, longing for some of your
oh.
Tender love.
Oh.
I'm waiting for the right
shine.
Moment to come, so I can thank you for
June Allison with some really great news. Now you can get a sample of any Depend absorbent product free. Just call 1-800-FON-WGST.
Lion of Judah, Seed of Solomon, Son of Sheba. American Thread Indicator. My three-wife-having dreadlock-looking brother. How you living?
Rasta greetings to you, brother.
Greeting, Irie Rasta. Greetings to you, Dred, you Rastafari.
Hey, you know what? I got the business section here from Thursday's Atlanta Constitution.
Well.
And right here it says,
264 billion.
Tallying black economic power.
I saw it.
It's likely to top $16 billion.
In Georgia.
In Georgia.
In Georgia.
And this was so stark because the gentleman today from wherever he was in Europe just bought a big tract of land downtown for $100 million. I'm saying that we got enough money to buy tracts of land, build hotels on them, buy sports franchises, our own factories, our own everything. We wouldn't have to ask nobody for nothing if we would just turn our dollars over.
Why don't we go to Vine City? I've been saying this since day one. Go to Vine City and buy up everything over there.
Speak, brother.
Everything in Vine City. That property is going to turn to gold. Right now, if you ride the MARTA train, my brother, the Vine City station is deserted. But if a business-minded, clear-thinking, futuristic, focused-type brother like yourself or myself could really envision what that Vine City station is going to be like, it's going to be awesome, man.
That's right. You see, we have enough money now where we don't even have to ask for no other man or no other community to come in and buy. We could just strictly sell to each other and do well. I look at other groups, and you mentioned one tonight, who target an area that they want to take over.
And they get it.
And they go and get it.
That's right.
And then we line up to give them our dollars every single day.
And I don't blame them for raking them in. I don't blame them.
We get paid on Friday.
Mm-hmm.
Monday morning, they got it all back.
We dead broke.
But on the...
You know, there's an old joke. I can't tell it because they'll say it's a racial joke. But you know the joke about the three men in hell, and the one man wishes for fame, another man wishes for a lot of money. And then another man wants some cheap jewelry in that man's address. Let's go.
Yeah, well, that's about how it's going. So I sound like a stuck record, but I would say, black people, your freedom is in your own hands. Your salvation or whatever you're looking for is within your own hands right now. You're throwing it away. You're wasting it.
We're blooping it up in smoke. We're swallowing it.
Drinking it up.
Mm-hmm.
You wear the most expensive shoes. You got to be walking with all the gold on. You got to be looking good wherever you go. And nobody really cares.
What about uniforms for black people? Let's trade in these starter jackets and go to green khaki like the Chinese.
Well, brother, it would kill two birds with one stone, because first of all, it would put the seed of uniformity in our minds.
Mm-hmm.
And secondly, it would free up this money so that these parents could go about the business of buying land.
That's right.
Because it's not making, they're not making no more of it.
That's right. They're not making no more land. And like Scarlett says, well, that's Scarlett, her daddy. What did he tell a man in Gone with the Wind? He said, land.
That's right.
Land is the only thing. You know, men will betray you, but land. Land, Katie Scarlett O'Hara, land. That's what we need, American Dread.
Right. May I touch briefly on another subject, brother?
Tomorrow, yeah. Okay. We got to go tonight, my baby. Appreciate your call, good man. Coming back to the big O in Marietta, Mark Indicator, Missa Lee in Stone Mountain, 233 WGST, 1-800-FON-WGST. Who am I? Who am I? Who am I?
Daughter of baby. From your womb shall come the firstborn of a king, giving birth to a mighty nation of blood-stained spears and thundering black shields.
Boom, 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 boom.
Boom, boom.
If you miss a day, you miss a...
If I tried to dance like Mick Jagger, I'd probably kill myself. You know, what does he do? Do the dance, George, do it. There we go. I don't know why we're having so much fun down here at News Radio 640 WGST. We got a big pervert performance coming up at 11 o'clock. Wholesome radio right here for you, right here on News Radio 640 WGST.
back to the calls. The big old Otis. How you living, Otis?
I'm fine. Listen, I was down at the Apostle Valley about the same time you were. I don't remember you being there, but I listened to your program. I appreciate you.
What kind of work did you do down there?
I was working on the carpenter crew.
You on the carpenter crew on a...
Yeah, I was on down there about a week.
A week?
Yeah.
I might have fired you.
Yeah, I don't know.
Did you work for Lashley and Company? Ivy and Associates?
Associates,
huh? Yeah, dude, the boss man had a couple of gray pickup trucks. We had a trail over there next to the liquor store.
Big and kind of redheaded looking.
Yeah, right, right. Alan Ivy.
I don't know, I can't remember his name.
Yeah, we fired you for drinking down there.
Probably drinking some of that old Must I Tell.
Must I Tell it? Must I Clown?
You know what? Well, I want to tell you how I appreciate you and what you're trying to do here and everything. And I'm a former Clansman, but I'm appreciating you and you're doing a good job. And I've changed everything around now. I changed my life. And just want to tell you how much I appreciate you.
You mean to tell me I changed you from the era of your way? I got you to see the era?
No, my wife actually did. I married a very wonderful lady, black lady.
You mean a former Klansman married a black woman?
Yeah, I did.
Y'all got any kids?
No, we don't have any kids, yeah. But, you know, she's a wonderful person. Her friends and family don't like it too much sometimes, but, you know.
Do you know Daniel Carver?
I heard of him, yeah. He's one of them. She says that. She tells a friend I'm a former Klansman, but I'm now a wizard under the sheets.
You're a wizard under the sheets now.
Uh-huh.
Otis, I appreciate your call, man. I used to have a guy who worked on my lawnmowers and chainsaws. I know he's still kicking out there in College Park. Oh, Otis Armstrong. Y'all not any kin, are you?
No, Otis Armstrong, but...
The big old out there on Stonewall Tail. He's an authorized Toro snapper, craftsman. What did I get? A Poland. I had a bad Poland 3.4 counter vibe. You ever cut firewood, Otis?
Uh-huh, yeah.
You ever use a Poland or a steel chainsaw?
It was one of them Beavers, I think.
Beaver, right. McCulloch. You had one of them Beavers.
Beavers, all they call it.
Man, y'all was cutting wood by hand.
A lot of it. I was down there in Privy Corners, Alabama.
Mm-hmm.
Where I'm from.
Privy Corners, Alabama.
A little small town.
Small town.
Yeah.
And you were down on a fairly popular project with me, and I probably fired you.
Yeah.
Well, at least you drew your unemployment, at least, though, man.
Yeah, I got some of that in the rocking chair, anyway.
There you go. You take care of that good-looking woman of yours, man. Appreciate your call, buddy, checking in. We had Mark out there in Carroll County, and now we got Otis in Marietta. Let's go to another Mark in Decatur. Mark, thank you for calling. You're on the talk. How you like Posse?
Organizational in Africa and try to get international equal trade and start doing business. Us black who say we make $16 billion,
mm-hmm.
Let's take some of the $16 billion and choose carefully, pray over and ask God to guide you, and choose a nation over there that we can establish trade with, and we can start pumping money back into Africa, and sort of back in Divine City or something like that. And all of that, we may be able to establish sort of like trade, money, and build our country back up at the same time. And then we should look at what Bush did as a light, and we should demand equal international trade, and we should do that.
Okay, you know, for a first-time caller, I'm not going to jump on you. There's some fine points that we can discuss quickly, Mark, and one is, collectively, as the people, we need to get our act together right here in America. I mean, it's good for us and noble for us to focus on a lot of international issues, and God knows we should be thinking a lot better and a lot more about Africa, and we should. But the unfortunate part of the picture is we're not clear on what we're about here in America. We got a high unemployment rate, these homosexuals running berserk, black and white. You know, and our morals are really going to pot. And when we're talking about contributing to Africa, you know, Africa doesn't want any junk. They want the best that America has to offer. And if we can collectively come together under some kind of real serious economic program, then I think they will welcome us with open arms. What we could do in the meantime is take the United States, we can take South Africa, and even Israel before the United Nations, and charge them with violating human rights. Israel and violating the Palestinian rights, the United States in violating our human rights here in America, and the South Africans in violating the human rights of those brothers and sisters in South Africa, then the whole world will be behind us, as opposed to us begging for some civil rights bill. We can take them before the UN, the world body, since we sanctioned Saddam, let's sanction South Africa and their cousin, the United States, and their stepchild, Israel. Then we can get some serious action for the oppressed people on the planet. But you got some good thoughts, man, and I don't want to, you know, deter you from your thoughts because a lot of folks sitting around here haven't done a bloody thing all day. Yeah, you sorry. Sitting around here ain't done a bloody thing all day. Keep on thinking about Africa, Ma. Keep on thinking. Keep on thinking.
But the kettle's on the boil, and we're so easily gone away.
Do you know there are only 44 sounds in the English language? 44. And when you learn these 44 sounds called phonics, you can read and spell almost everything. That's why Hooked on Phonics is so successful. We've set these 44 sounds to music, making learning to read simple and fun. So get hooked on phonics and take the mystery out of learning to read. Call 1-800-ABCDEFG.
Okay, picture this. How many times have you rushed to a sale and thought, this is all that's on sale? Well, take a look at the National Home Appliance Sale at Sears Brand Central, where virtually every major brand's on sale, like a large-capacity Kenmore washer-dryer pair for just $476 now through Saturday, or a Fisher 8mm Lolux camcorder for just $799.88, a closeout while quantities last. So hurry to Sears Brand Central before, well, you get the picture.
Gotta go.
Prices may vary in Alaska, Hawaii, and Puerto Rico.
All about the South, folks are waking up to savings at Rich's One Day Sale, where you find Simmons Beauty Rest Harmony twin mattresses for $98 each piece. Buy any king or queen set and get an extra 10% off. Additional styles of twin mattresses are on sale starting at $129 and $179 twin each piece. Choose from Simmons, Stearns & Foster, Sealy, and Serta. Rich's One Day Sale for mattress savings. Remember, an extra 10% off king and queen sets. Wednesday only. It's one great day to save.
No matter the time of day, when you want to know what's going on, we've got it. We're here every minute, every day, for you. News Radio 640 WGST.
Hi, Ralph. This is Sean Robinson. How are you?
Back. Back.
Yeah.
Back.
Yeah.
Bad girls don't.
Daddy, I like your show.
I saw her picture in the magazine.
The Book of Ebony. The Black Bible. Yeah, I know what you mean. Sean Robinson off of page 31. There are no more ebonies. No more ebonies in the tri-state area. Lee, on the rock.
Raul.
Lee.
It's a pleasure.
It's my pleasure.
Look here, I got two questions I want to ask you, and then I have two recommendations I want to make to you.
All right.
The first question I want to ask you is, I have plans to become a preacher, and I know you spent plenty of time talking to Reverend Al Sharpton yesterday. What I want to know is, how do you do that buck dance? I need the money, Ralph, and I want to need to know how to do that buck dance.
You know who does the best buck dance in town? And I joke about him, and I really like the brother. I talk about him, but I like him because I have seen him go in his pocket. I don't know whose money it was, but he went in his pocket and contributed to some worthy causes. It seems like I'm always around when people are begging. But Quincy Carswell.
Oh, Quincy's good.
Quincy is an aerobic evangelical exercising fool.
What?
He can moonwalk in that pulpit. He can spin. He can hiccup. He can wheeze like a donkey. He gave you money's worth. You know, Quincy's church is like Las Vegas. You get music. You get those bad sisters up in there falling out, throwing their legs all up in there. You get sit all.
Yes.
They even had a couple of pigeons that they threw out, you know. The sisters went berserk. They talking about the Holy Ghost is among us. The Holy Ghost is among us. Little boy holler, hey, Reb, the cat done ate the Holy Ghost.
That's the second question, Rob.
But Quincy Carswell is a moonwalking, Jericho-wearing evangelical freak.
He's a crook, Rob, is what he is.
No, he's not.
He's a crook.
He is not a crook. He is not a crook. Quincy Carswell worships Jesus, man. He worships the Lord.
He just can't get him out of that church.
He is not a crook.
Okay, he's
Quincy Carswell is a decent human being.
Okay, I agree.
Although he's still wearing what's that spandex pants and thing. He's cool. He's not a crook.
Okay.
You'll never hear that here on my show.
One more thing, Ralph. They're going to make the Hilton, the new and improved Hilton, is now going to be pedestrian friendly.
What do you mean?
That's what they said, now. I'm telling you what they said.
You talking about this massive 11-block downtown Midtown project that's being unveiled by a Swedish builder?
It's going to be pedestrian-friendly.
Now, explain to me what pedestrian-friendly means.
That was my other question to you. You brought it up. I'm going to tell you what pedestrian-friendly is. As long as you have a hole, that's pedestrian-friendly. Okay.
No, pedestrian friendly means you can walk through the place and things.
As long as you got a hole.
Oh, that's right. Okay, if you're not a vagrant, I got you. I got right. You. Bye, Lee. Bye. Oh, no, I apologize for being so silly tonight, and I'm sober. I just don't know what it is. Gary in Stone Mountain. We'll go back to the Rock one more time. Maybe it's some serious business up on the Rock this time.
Greetings, Pilgrim. David.
Oh, my goodness.
Greetings, Pilgrim, as we slide down the razor blade of life on our Georgia-style, up-tempo New York-style talk show.
Too quick for you.
How can I help you in some insignificant kind of way? I am Ralph Robitaille. You know your name.
Okay, Ralph. I've been trying to call you ever since I heard that first Boortz promo, and then I just heard it again.
That's what I'm saying.
He is going to crucify the young blacks tomorrow. I just
tune in. It's gonna be fun. It's nothing but fun. I'm telling you now. Neal is an expert talk show host. He knows how to crank it up.
Yeah, he's gonna do. And they just gave him some information tonight. I know he's just gonna run with it. Now, what gets me more
gonna be good
is how come we get generalized with things when it comes out. Now, if Neal says something or if Brian says something, it says this is what Neal said. This is what Brian said. But if Ralph. It's Ralph and the blacks think this. Me, Ralph from Ben Hill thinks this, and Gary from Stone Mountain thinks this, and so-and-so over here thinks this.
It's the black.
It's generalized together, and that's what's going to happen with this. They're going to see it in the morning. Guy's going to call in. Oh, you see them blacks doing this. That just boggles the mind. How come we are not individual? We're grouped together. 30 million of us, and we're all the same.
You know, that's the problem that they're having with Clarence Thomas. You know, he's not a member of the pegged group today. They thought they had all Negroes figured out. Now, where did they get this Negro from? He's conservative. He's a Republican. He's a judge. Wait a minute. You know, that's the way it is. But the bottom line is, Gary, when you're clear thinking, when you're sober-minded, when you are intelligent and you're articulate, fairly articulate like some of us are, you know, they've never heard this before. This is a rarity on the radio here in this major market area. You know, you get a lot of the tobacco chewing, stump jumping good old boys. They'll check in, and you got your housewives and your smart ass white boys riding around in their mobile phones and whatnot, showing off and things. But when they hear the colored folks talking at night, you know, we only have 1,000 watts. They can't understand it.
Yeah, I was in D.C. yesterday, so I didn't get a chance.
The last colony. Where about in D.C. were you?
It was Fairfax.
Oh, you were in Virginia then. Well, say that.
Right near there.
Say that.
So I caught the talk show up there. They spoke a lot about boys in the hood.
Uh-huh.
Did you speak about it here?
I'm going to reserve comment on it until I go see it. You know, I'm supposed to be up on the cutting edge, and I was way late yesterday in my attempt to see it. I was there when New Jack City came out the first day, there when Jungle Fever came out. I pumped up New Jack City so much it broke my heart. Nobody wanted to talk about it. I pumped up Jungle Fever. Nobody. We got a little mileage out of Jungle Fever, the interracial deal. But, you know, I'm going to go see Regarding Henry and Boys in the Hood because my main man, Bill Nunn, from Atlanta, my roommate. See, all of my posse, people think I just sprung up like Topsy. I'm like that little girl in Gone with the Wind. I didn't just spring up. I hung with a group of brothers that are smoking. The brother who played Gator in Jungle Fever, Samuel Jackson, is right here. We were stage actors together at the Morehouse College, Morehouse Spelman Players, also the Clark Players, here at Just Us Theater and some more groups here, New Cosmos Cultural Theater. Bill Nunn is kicking butt. He's in Regarding Henry with Harrison Ford. Big time role for a brother, man, to be opposite Harrison Ford. We talking about Indiana Jones. We talking about, who did he play? Han's Solo. What was that part he played in the Star Wars or whatever? We talking about big time actor. And now we got Kenny Leon running the Alliance Theater here. All of us come from the same crew. Except when I was in the plays, they would always make me play the wino, you know, or the old man. They would get all the women, and they would have the most lines. But whenever I got on that stage, boy, you knew I was out there home.
Too late, Ralph. It's never too late. You got the talent. That's one thing
I'm working every night, man.
You got the talent, and you're coming along. I seen the change in you in the last 6 months, and you just keep on keep it on.
Yeah, I'm feeling my oats, man. I'm smelling
you
myself.
But that message was so deep in this movie.
Oh, yeah.
Well,
Boys in the Hood.
It was so realistic.
It was.
It was just too realistic.
Did it make you want to jump on somebody when you came out?
No. Right. New Jack City, It may have gotten a little broad when they took over the building. That might can't happen.
Okay.
The movie was...
It was real.
It was just too real.
Where did you watch the flick? Where did you watch the flick? That's a code for where did you see the movie?
Sunday.
Where? In Fairfax.
Yeah, at Fairfax.
Was it an all black movie? I mean, were all the people?
It was mixed.
Mm-hmm.
It was mixed, and the white crowd got a lot of enjoyment out of it too. A lot of them called in on that talk show the next day.
Did y'all jump on some white folks up there?
Oh no.
Good.
The crowd was well behaved.
Good. So very orderly colored people, in other words.
Yeah. Right. Made it a little deeper at the end. I didn't like the way it ended. They should have showed a little more. You see it.
Okay.
Should they just...
Is anybody naked? Anybody naked?
Hmm?
Anybody naked?
Yeah.
Breast?
Hmm?
Breast?
Yeah. Yeah. And that's why I don't know if I could take my son to it, and I don't know how you feel about taking your...
How many breasts? Was it one?
Two.
Oh, it wasn't Nancy. Good. Hey, I'm going to check it out, Gary. Appreciate your call. I'm going to check it out. Boys in the Hood. Just keeping up with all these movies will make me go crazy, though, man. I gotta go see Boys in the Hood. I gotta go see Regarding Henry. Oh, man, come on. And I gotta watch my video. You know, we did a video at the remote. Yeah. No breasts. Oh, when the Friendship Force makes this historic trip to Jerusalem in the fall, will you be aboard? For a chance to win one of two round-trip seats, for this historic mission, write an essay in 100 words or less about how and why you would like to go to Jerusalem. Jeru means city. Salam means peace. Jerusalem to wage peace with the Friendship Force. Send your essay to Atlanta-Jerusalem, 100 Colony Square, Suite 200, Atlanta, Georgia, with a J, 30361. Winners will be announced on News Radio 640 WGST on the Brian Wilson. No, on the station. The first week of August. And for more information on the Friendship Force Jerusalem Exchange, call 2222-2001. That's 2222-2001. Hit it.
The Federal Jobs Digest is a newspaper that publishes civil service job information. Every issue lists over 20,000 immediate openings in all occupations at salaries up to $78,000 without tests. These include jobs in your area. A subscription to the Federal Jobs Digest costs $29. To order, call now, 1-800-543-8000. Again, 1-800-543-8000.
When you take a close look at Prego spaghetti sauce and Ragu Old World style.
Close? You don't have to look close. Prego is obviously thicker. See? Right here. Prego's got big chunks, see?
I can see it.
Yeah, Ragu is obviously thinner. No chunks, not here.
I can see it, but what about all the people listening?
Let me tell you something. Prego is so much thicker than Ragu, you can even see it on radio.
I see what you're saying. That's a real difference. Prego is thicker, and it shows.
You don't even have to see it to see it.
I want you to stay up late tonight after Arsenio. Flip on over to Channel 2. I'm going to be on the Love Connection. Sean Robinson and Ralph from Ben Hill. We're going to be telling about our date, everything we did, and 2 and 2. You know, they gave me a chance to let the audience pick me a date or to go back out with Sean again. And, I chose Sean.
I say to myself,
all right, that is second. We got the Renegade, we got OZ, and I hate to crucify Bruce, but Brucey, come on with you, Bruce.
Oh, you can't crucify me.
Come on.
All right, well, first off, I need to know, where is this Quincy Carswell church anyway?
I think it's Tabernacle Baptist, it's on Boulevard, it's over there between North Avenue and... No, on the other side of Ponce de Leon. It's on Boulevard. Just look in the yellow pages. Just follow the drip over there on Boulevard. You'll find the church. OZ, Lathonia, how you living?
I'm doing okay. Ralph, first of all, I want to compliment you for admitting that you're going to be on the number one network in the city tonight, Channel 2, a Love Connection.
You work for Channel 2 or something?
Yeah, I'm a photographer for Channel 2.
Channel 2?
News person.
Is Sandra Bookman as fine in person as she is on TV?
Well, I can give you a comment, and it'll probably be yes, but I'm not going to do that.
Well, tell Sandra Bootman I love her. I think she's unforgettable. But not quite as unforgettable as Renee Chenault and Sean Robinson. Renegade, you're the last man I'm on board.
Hey, man, how you doing?
Living large.
Hey, that's great. Okay, I want to make two comments, okay?
Hit it.
Okay, we talk about homosexuals. And you worship Allah, okay? I worship Jesus, okay? I ain't trying to get no
Batman. Call me tomorrow. Clings to me. I got a romance and fantasize, you know. Yeah, you wait till 2 minutes before I got to get out of here. George rushing me, Gene rushing me, Liz rushing me. And you call up talking about philosophize. Well, we had a good time tonight. We had a good time. Unforgettable show.
Unforgettable. In every way.
Ladies and gentlemen, Sean Robinson is coming to town. She's coming very soon. Coming to see me.
And forevermore.
And forevermore.
That's how.
I got a couple of Greyhound tickets, and she's going to catch the bus. She'll be riding the Greyhound bus. I sent her some fried chicken and potato salad, UPS. She's going to come down here on the Greyhound bus. You know, you can go half fare and family anywhere in the country. She'll be down here. She's going to leave, I think, tomorrow. She should get here sometime next week. I'll bring her in right here, let you talk to her. I want you to stay tuned to News Radio 640 WGST for Tom Hughes. First thing in the morning, solder your dial, glue your dial to News Radio 640 WGST. Keith Callen, Steve Holman, Tom Hughes, Harry Beadle, Tammy Lloyd, Wade Medlock, is it Made Wetlock? And everybody's gonna be here first thing in the morning. And they better play my promo too. In drive time.
Hi Ralph, this is Sean Robinson. How are you?
You know, it's good to know that your talk show host is human. It's good to know that I have some emotion, that I'm a real man, and I'm in love with a woman and not some other man.
Unforgettable.
I'll tell you.
In every way.
I stopped by Abby Hall over there at Spelman College today and said a few prayers at the Sean Robinson Shrine, Abby Hall. Yeah, it's the new Sean Robinson Shrine, Spelman College. Well, that's how they make them over there on the yard, you know?
That's why, darling, it's incredible.
Don't you hate for me to leave? I'm so much fun. You know, now you got Rush Limbaugh, you know? Come on, Larry King, what's the question? I'll be back, 7 o'clock tomorrow, fresh, smoking, mean. In the meantime, you live large and prosper.
Robinson, how are you? My number is 414.
Let's get out of here.
The official 3-day Weather Channel forecast is updated every hour of every day, exclusively on News Radio 640 WGST, Atlanta's most trusted news, traffic, and weather station.